Have you ever been one of the first people to attend to a bereavement? Have you been with a family in those moments after a loved one has died? What did you say to those grieving? What on earth do you say to comfort people when their emotions are raw and they stare blankly over the edge of an uncertain future? I remember visiting an old friend who was in ICU as she was dying from cancer. I arrived at the hospital in Springs and noticed in the car park someone sitting and sobbing at one of the cars. I thought that perhaps someone had died. I walked along the passage as a man emerged from the ICU and walked in my direction. He stopped, overcome with sorrow, and leant up against the corridor wall, weeping. I walked over and put my hand on his shoulder to comfort him. He looked up at me and I looked deeply into his eyes. "Please go and help my family. They're in the ICU." I nodded and went in. There I found the rest of the family standing around the bed with the elderly lady who had just died. I put my arm around someone and they welcomed the embrace. One by one, I hugged the family and they responded, "Thank you for coming." I told them that I was sorry. It was a somber and sad mood. "May I say a prayer?" I asked. They nodded gratefully. We took hands, and looking at the old lady, I prayed as heartfelt and hopeful a prayer as I could manage. Some started to cry, but I sensed that this was helping to bring closure. Once we finished, they said their final farewells and left. "Thank you, Pastor, for being here." We hugged and they went off. I walked over to the nurse's station and asked for my friend. "Oh, wow, you had two people here in the ICU?" "No." I explained that I had just come upon this family and they asked me to help. "Oh," said the nurse, "well, we called a pastor to come and we assumed it was you." I always wondered what happened to that pastor when he arrived at the hospital to find that everyone had already gone home, comforted in some small way. Sometimes we are called into these types of situations. A crisis, when someone dies, when a friend is diagnosed with cancer, when someone is retrenched, when someone is cheated or robbed or abused. What do we say? In the book of Job, when the devil had unleashed every kind of mishap and mayhem onto poor Job, and as he sat on the ash heap scratching his wounds with a piece of pottery, into that scenario his friends came. For 7 days they sat with him and didn't utter a word. They were there for their friend, but they also had their own understanding of Job's situation running through their minds. If only they had kept quiet, this would have been comfort enough, but they couldn't help themselves. They felt they had to say something, and here is where their words exposed their hearts. Some were legalistic, others were judgmental. Even Job's wife was a fatalist. "Curse God and die. Get it over with." And so the friends, instead of lifting his spirits, helped to drag Job down into a place where he even cursed the day of his birth. There were no answers, no advice, no theology or Bible verse that was going to help. If they had continued to sit with Job in silence, this would have been a better option. Why do we feel the need to say something? "God needed another angel in heaven." I've heard that said at funerals. It doesn't help. No amount of rationalizing, explaining, justifying, or accusing brings comfort to a person in distress. Everything will turn out for the best. Though theologically correct, this offers little to a wounded heart. Just being there, being present, not saying anything is much better. Being present and praying for someone is good medicine for the soul. We are being bombarded by people trying to speak into our present crisis. Some are trying to speak for God to make sense of the trouble and trials. Some are trying to maintain an air of triumphalism. Some are taking a fatalistic stance. Can I suggest that we keep our thoughts to ourselves? In Proverbs, it is the wise person who has few words and the fool who can't stop talking. Let's demonstrate some wisdom in these times. Matt Redman wrote a song entitled, "Let My Words Be Few." You are God in heaven, and here am I on earth, so I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so in love with you. During this time, we need to lift our eyes from our circumstances and consider our sovereign God, and then let our words be few. We looked at Psalm 46 that says, "Be still and know that I am God." We sing these words in a lovely, gentle song, but that is very different from the mood of the psalm. In the chaos of kingdoms and nature colliding and challenging and creating catastrophes, there is a call to be quiet. Cease fire. Stop. And know that I am God. Stop speaking and arguing and ranting and raving, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in all the earth. This is not a gentle word, but a rebuke and a decisive declaration about who is in charge. And it's not you, Mr. President, or Madam Chancellor, or King, or Prime Minister, or whoever thinks they have authority. Know that I am God. We may all guess at what is lying ahead for this world, but one thing I am sure about is that God is in complete control and He will be exalted among the nations. And so when we who know this God, who know the tremendous love and power of King Jesus, when we are called to come alongside those who are dying, who are depressed, disenfranchised, derelict, or in spiritual dungeons, let our words be few. Rather, let us simply be present and let us pray. And then let us watch as God is exalted in all the earth. Ecclesiastes 5 verse 2, "Do not be quick with your mouth. Do not be hasty in your heart to utter anything before God. God is in heaven and you are on earth. So let your words be few."
You are God in heaven, and here am I on earth. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so in love with you.
Heavenly Father, I pray that you would place me in situations where I can be useful for your kingdom, not through my words, but by bringing the presence of the Holy Spirit and the power of the love of Jesus to bear in situations. Lord, then we can see you being glorified in another's life as their lives are transformed for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, I am so in love with you.